Pugachev. Not everything, no. Yeah, thank you very much, Stefan. Thank you very much for inviting and for coming to this presentation. So because there are too many slides, so I without explaining who I am, it was explained by Stefan nicely. So thank you, Stefan. I go to the to my presentation, and that is about entry and exit. The difference from droplet impact is that that is kind of big scale. So it's about ships, about the high-speed vessels, about aircraft. So that is the ditching. Everything in this presentation will be about suction forces, or mainly about suction. So the forces which are negative, or pressures which are below atmospheric ambient pressure. Let me introduce my collaborator, and first the Tatiana Khabakhpasheva. She is here. That is yeah. We are working for many years together, and she is employed by UEA as a researcher, and also she is a researcher in the project, our project with Stefan. Then Kevin Mackey from University of Michigan. It's open form calculations with everything, air, water, Navier-Stokes equation, surface tension, then Sofik Seng, he is from BV, now again it's in La Défense, and also open form, but another version. Then Patricia and Javier Rodriguez from University Carlos Terrer in Madrid. So they did experiments. So altogether, the that presentation is made of three parts. One is theoretical, so how to make the simplest model, and the second it's a kind of numerical, how to use the CFD data to make theoretical models, and third one is about experiments on water exit. So. First, it's everything we can say was started from that this cut, and a famous paper published 8 years ago by Rice and others, and it's about cut lapping. So you lift water, or milk in this case, upwards, and it was shown. Yeah, it's obvious that without adhesion, it cannot be like that. However, it was also shown by experiments with that robot, and which was to simulate the cut tank motion, that there is nothing about viscosity, surface tension, and other things, and everything is about inertia, just inertia. So they did experiments, and they obtain that result, and there is the gravity, which is a restoring force, right? So just two. So that is good. And also, you can see from video, they recorded the velocity of the tank, and the velocity is shown by blue line, and you can see that the acceleration, just this velocity minus that velocity divided by time between them, it's about 20 meters per second squared, so it's about 2g. So it's motions with large acceleration, so there is not many things about surface tension, right? And the other applications or situations in which we can find that negative pressure are about the so-called wet deck impact, when wave moves under the platform deck and impacting on it, so there is impact stage, and after that the contact area say shrinking, so that is kind of exit stage. That is what studied in the PhD dissertation by Barholm, and Faltinson was his supervisor. So the forces acting on the platform are shown over here, and you can see that positive force during the impact, this is what we all of us are concerned, even in droplet impact, we are concerned with impact, but not what's happening next. And here you can see that after the impact on that stage, when the contact area is shrinking, the force is negative, right? And the amplitude, you can see, amplitude of the force is the same. So it's about 70 and it's about 70. So if we are so much concerned about impact forces, why we are not thinking even about the negative forces, right? So in some sense, the to damage surface is easier if you are trying to remove something from the surface than pressing the surface. By pressing to the surface, you do not damage the surface, right? But by sucking, you can do this, right? And especially it could be important for coastal structure, like a wave impact on the walls. Right, so and you see also that negative forces or negative loads, they last longer, right? So it's interesting result here. They did experiments, and they did simulations by potential flow theory, boundary element method. You see it's fit nicely. However, the calculations, because in a potential solver there are no viscosity, so there are no adhesion, so there should be something added to that. And they assume that the contact line when wetted area is shrinking is a material line. So the velocity of that line, normal velocity of that line along the surface is equal to the velocity of the fluid at that on that line. So this is extra. It doesn't follow from anything, but this is comes kind of the this is element from the viscosity, because viscosity is not there. There are no such problem in open form. For traveling wave, it was done by Barholm and Faltinson, and for standing wave by Skolan and Fabiano Remy. Then the calculations, first calculation computations were done by Pierre and Mackie in 2011, and from that time we started to work on exit. It doesn't mean that we didn't work on exit before. But the model which we tried to develop, it was so simple that we couldn't believe that it's possible to do something with that model. It was too simple. But after that, after this calculation, so they did a hydroelastic wedge and an exit. Actually, it's not. It's a rigid wedge in their paper. And this is the force. So they calculated, and some theoretical. But theoretical, it's not good. So they do not look at the dashed line. So only on the blue line. So blue line is a CFD result, and you can see again that the when wedge enter water, the forces are positive, and after that they are negative. But here, in addition, the negative forces, even in amplitude, they are larger than positive forces, and they last much longer. So that is the CFD, and looking at that, and in 2011, I remember it appeared in September, and in October we did already, we developed it, our model finally, to compare with that result, and from that time we started to work on it. This is the kind of general what's happening. So the body penetrates into the water, so that is the solid body or its deformable body penetrates into the water, and first stage is impact stage. And at this stage we know many things, and in particular we know that the properties of the surface and the viscosity, gravity, surface tension is not so important if the dimensions are large, like dimensions for the several meter per second. Several meter per second, I mean velocity, and the sizes is about meters. Then once the body enter water, and after that it's exit from the water, that is the exit stage. For exit stage, say 7 years ago, we did now a lot enough, so now we have more ideas about it, and that is the kind of introduction to water exit problem. So exit problem is the focus of this presentation. Entry we need to know, because the first body enters water and then exits water. So if our description of impact and entry is not proper, we cannot expect that second stage will be described well. This is the reason. So then the problem formulation is shown over here. So the initially everything at rest and body is sitting, and we consider only shapes such that if the shape exits from water, it doesn't make flow. So the flow is not by the shape. And then we list, there is the list all possible effects. Okay, inertia, definitely. Gravity could be, surface tension, viscosity, shape of the body, and quality of water surface. And in our model, it was the we neglected everything except of inertia. Everything was neglected, including shape. So that is interesting, but later it was confirmed by simulations. So we did analysis of scales. Gravity, if the acceleration of the body is W, then if the gravity can be neglected, if acceleration is high, for example 2G is already high acceleration, and the viscosity can be neglected if the size of the body shape is larger than that one, and it's likely to be that. Surface tension also can be neglected if the size, linear dimensions of the body are larger than capillary length, and then we consider only initial stage, small displacement, and the flat disk approximation is used, so everything is linearized on the body surface, and that is the problem. So that is the something which appeared, I cannot say many, but many years ago, but we couldn't believe that it worked. Actually it worked. So then this is the initial situation, so that is the contact region, so the projected on the equilibrium water surface. Actually there is the certain shape, but we do not account for that shape. That is the linearized body condition, so imposed on the initial level, and initial water level, say water level or milk level, say, yeah, that is the linearized dynamic condition. So phi t plus 1 over 2 quadratic term, there could be gravity, so there are no gravity, there are no nonlinearity, so just phi t equal to 0. The point is, the difference of that problem, exit problem from impact problem, is that we cannot integrate that condition. We cannot say that phi equal to 0, it's not. Mm-hmm. So then we work with acceleration potential, not with velocity potential, acceleration potential, which is still equal to 0 on the water surface, but that condition becomes more complicated. Then Because in this problem that phi is velocity potential, so this potential theory, there is no viscosity. To simulate the viscosity, we assume that speed of that point, contact point, is proportional with some coefficient gamma, which depends on viscosity, on properties, surface, or properties of the liquid, multiplied by velocity of the fluid at that point. Mm-hmm. So that is the condition. It came from the numerical simulations by Faltinson and Barholm. What we did extra, we introduced gamma. Gamma was equal to 1 in their numerical simulations. Phi x is the horizontal velocity at that point. Horizontal velocity at that point. Phi dx. Yeah, so then we need to solve this problem, and the solution is that one. Just that one. This is the solution. That is the solution. So that is the, if we introduce, if our pressure, linearized pressure, is given by linearized Bernoulli equation, then that mixed boundary value problem solved. Do you have another one? It's not good, yeah. Pointer, no? No. Okay. No pointer, okay. Which one? Yeah. Good. So that is the solution, but the solution only over here. This is only what we need to know. We need do not need to know what's happening everywhere, just over here. So then this mixed boundary problem solved, and the solution is given by the square root, and that coefficient over here is the acceleration of the body. Then, by integrating the pressure, we can find the force acting on the body during the exit, and it's given by this formula, right? Where MA is eddy mass of the flat disk, and that is the acceleration. Right? So it's a little bit different from that classical eddy mass theory. Because in classical eddy mass, force is equal to time derivative of eddy mass multiplied by velocity. Right? Here, there are no derivative of eddy mass. That is the difference. Yeah, so then if we know the pressure, phi t, we can integrate, we can find potential, then we differentiate in x, and we can find the velocity of the liquid along the boundary. It's given by this formula. Then we combine this equation where h is h 2 prime acceleration of the body, and c is size of the contact area. And we combine with the equation for the velocity of the contact points, and we arrive at that nonlinear singular integral differential equation for that C. So looks complicated. Yes, indeed, it's complicated. So in that equation, C to be determined, and H is given. That is equation. It's not just for constant acceleration, for any motion, can be reduced to system of two equations. This is actually, we solve that two systems, where sigma is a kind of time-like variable, and f stands for the size of the contact area. These two equations can be simplified for the constant acceleration. That is the conditions of computation by Mackie and Pierre. For constant acceleration, this part is constant and given, so then this equation can be solved independently, and actually, after rescaling, it's reduced to that equation without any parameters. Means any exit, they are identical, any. It doesn't matter what the body, it doesn't matter what the acceleration, no, the acceleration should be constant. But the value of the acceleration doesn't matter. And then it's nonlinear and integral equation, but it's it can be solved because I'm teaching, and I'm teaching ordinary differential equation as well. And there is that Frobenius method, you could know it. And yeah, it works fine. it works fine. So the we can obtain the derive the recurrent relation for that coefficient, and yeah, it's solved. But it's not good to solve numerically because it's singular, and there is also, you can see singularity at sigma equal to 0 and singularity at sigma equal to 1. So it's better to solve it analytically, and we did it. So A, which one? A, yes, 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 yes. CT is size of the contact area, contact region. Yeah, so acceleration, but not through the shape. It's possible to relate the size of the contact region to the shape. Saying, yeah, if you leave the body, less portion of the body is in liquid. That is called von Karman technique. So this is the idea von Karman. So that is the, we do not account for deformation of the free surface, we account for that intersection. But in this case, it doesn't work. Because, as I said, the potentially we can solve this problem for, and it will be solved, and the experiments will be shown for disk, for flat disk, without draft. It's not just, it's on the surface. So then you lift the disk by 1 micrometer, and there are no contact, so it's impossible, right? So it's not about shape. It's not about shape. Shape is not there. It's a kind of suction. So yeah, so the that is in particular why yeah we were concerned that it's yeah it's very strange model. Yeah, it works. Right. Yep.
Could you remind us what is f, small f?
No, small. So yeah, this small f was introduced. By this formula. So it's convenient. It's convenient to introduce the, actually what we need to find from that from the equation is c as function of time, but instead of time we introduce sigma, and instead of c we introduce f. But yeah, I cannot say it took long time thanks to courses on ordinary differential equations where many takes like this. So actually it's not everything, but it's from there.
Because if acceleration is constant, that means that the expression here is constant.
Over here it's constant. Oh. So it's constant. But then we calculate f from here. We substitute f. Here it will be acceleration multiplied by t, and it gives equation for t as function of sigma. Yeah. Oops, and this is the comparison. So that is the end. That is the end. So we did everything. So the Pierre Marquis, they did calculation for parabolic shape. It doesn't look parabolic, but that is parabolic. With the initial velocity. Yeah, parabolic, yeah. The initial velocity is 1 meter per second, and deceleration over here, it's about 2D, right? And that is the blue line is our that theory, edit mass multiplied by acceleration, and the red line is the CFD with everything. And this is for wedge. Wedge is 10 degree, as I remember, and initial velocity 4 meters per second, and 10 g deceleration, and again red line is for CFD, and blue line our result. You see, because of this part, impact part, it's not well presented in our theory, but we can do this better. So the exit part also was not well fit. But over here, it's yeah, it's better than good. No, sure not, no. The everything, because we checked the calculation twice at least. And this is why I mentioned that Sophic thing. So the calculation were done in US, It's a good country, but also it's done in Paris. It's also a good country. Okay, Paris is not country, but in two different places, and the results are the same. So no. Yeah, we check. Yeah. It's easy. I mean, for me, who are writing equations, to blame the computations. Yeah. No, not in this case. Computations were quite very accurate. Yeah, but the interesting about the theory, that the so simple theory, it's well predict the computational result. If so, then it's just idea. If so, then it doesn't matter. Is it parabolic or wedge? It doesn't matter. It's the same, right? So if you do the same calculation, the same motion for wedge and for parabolic shape, they must be the same numerically. Right? So it's not about the theory. It's a theory just gives the idea what to do numerically. Right? So you see the and that was for small displacement, relatively small displacement and time. Yeah, it's non-dimensional time. So non-dimensional means the from this equation of motion, is parabolic motion, you can calculate time at which the body stops. So body penetrates, they stop and go out, and the time when the body stop at the lowest point is taken at the time scale. It's one, right? And you then it's also interesting from here to see, and it will be shown in next slide, that during the impact, when the body penetrates, but it's penetrated with deceleration, first the impact is impact loads are increasing, but after that they're decreasing, and they are negative at the end of impact stage, right? So more important is not where you're going in the fluid or out of fluid, more important how you're doing this. So the first, the body penetrates the liquid, accelerates the liquid, and after that it's the body decelerates, but liquid is already accelerated, it's been accelerated. So it continues to move, and it pull the body from that stage down. Right, so that is, and this is will be illustrated by kind of movie. That is for wedge 45 degrees, and the cases we compared over here. But the movie will be okay, kind of movie or cartoon will be shown for initial velocity 5 meters per second and deceleration 3 g, and so we calculate that size of the contact region, and you can see how we defined it. And that is the movie, right? So it's starting, right? It's starting and the body goes down. You see, okay. So that is the very high pressures. Very high pressures, body continues to penetrate, but there are no pressures. No loads at all. You see, no loads, it still goes down. And then loads are negative. So means body penetrates, still going in, but liquid pulls that body. It doesn't resist to the motion. It accelerates the body in some sense. Okay, in this case, the body cannot be accelerated because the motion of the body is given. And yeah, it's still going down. And now it's going up. And you see, it goes up. It's going from the fluid, and the loads are getting smaller. Then almost nothing, and but the body is still in contact with the fluid. And then, you see, it's positive loads again, because the once body goes from the water, it accelerates water, and water accelerated so much that it push the body from the fluid. Right. So first, a body accelerated fluid, and after that fluid, liquid accelerates the body. So yeah, that is interesting. Yeah, and that is the kind of final stage. Right. So that is by open form. Yeah, and then we try to use the that simulations to this result of computations to make our model even better. even better means to be applicable to large displacements, mm-hmm. or large, I mean, very big, not big, but the bodies which are not very flat, so beyond the assumption of our theory. And to do that, we use the so-called generalized Wagner model. That is interesting. More interesting here for discussion, say, it's that strangely this model were never used for droplet impact. It was used only for water entry. In this problem, in this approximation, that approximation is by Trau and Falkinson. Falkinson, yeah, he did many, many things, published in just proceedings, it's not paper even. The in this model, the we simplified, okay, it's potential flow, we simplified boundary condition, but only on the free surface. And we impose them, the boundary condition, on the so-called splash-up height. So that is the free surface goes up towards the body, so the vegetated area is larger than that just the air below the initial level, and then over here from that point we start that horizontal line, and we impose boundary condition on that line, so at h of t. So in this way we highly simplify the domain of the flow, but we do not simplify shape of the body and boundary condition of the body. Here they are the same, the boundary condition is the same as the original. And we simplify the condition, dynamic condition and kinematic condition on the free surface. You see the potential is equal to zero on the free surface. It's similar to the as in water entry problem. And the kinematic condition is also highly simplified, so it's linearized. So that is the generalized Wagner model. It's very good model due to many simplifications, but the main part of the problem, difficulties, is still there. And the Wagner condition, it's served to find the position of the of that C of T, position of that point. It's found. It's determined from the that C of T determined from the condition that elevation of the free surface at that point and position of the body at that point they are equal to each other. And then this is the we did that generalized Wagner model. We did in that paper. Well, not very recent paper. The generalized Wagner model, and that is the force acting on the wedge. The same wedge I showed more before, and that is the CFD, and this is the vertical force, and you can see initially it's quite okay, but later it's very different. And we argued that the this could be because of the gravity, so we need to account for gravity, but if we include gravity, then the problem becomes very complicated. So because it was not clear what's wrong in this model. As you said, it could be theory, but it could be computations, right? So then we kind of commissioned another computations done by Sophie Tseng, and they are shown in blue, and red is from Kevin Mackey, and that is the pressure at different time instant on the surface of the wedge entering water and then exiting water. So you see it's essentially the same. And that is the force. And force there is two lines, a green line and a blue line, that is from Tseng, and a red line, more smooth surface, is from the calculation by Mackey. The difference is that Tseng, he calculated everything. He calculated aerodynamic force, and also he calculated the effect of the jet. That because a jet make just rub-off in that impact problems, it doesn't contribute significantly to the forces. But that peaks, that all that things, they are because of that. And if we cut the jet, so if we, I believe we suggested them, okay, you calculated pressure distribution, integrate, but not everywhere, integrate up to that C of t, which you can calculate from your shape of this of the free surface. And then from Seng, the points are over there. So these dots, they are from these calculations, right? So then the means that once we compute something, it would be better if we use a kind of filter, proper filter. But we need to now and argue well what this filter is for. So there is no problem, it's not problem with the CFD, no. Problem with the theory, which is likely because the theory is too simple, and conditions we try to use the theory is more complicated than the theory was originally derived for. So we start with that general Wagner model again, and we introduce the gravity. That is the gravity. You can recognize phi t plus 1 over 2 second derivative velocity squared and plus g multiplied by elevation of the free surface. Right? So we still, there are still no quadratic term, but now it's elevation of free surface over there. And then we are saying, yeah, but that s, you see, we approximate it is with h of t, which is elevation at the drop of, so plus up height. So approximately that phi t is given by that one. But then we can, if a function given on the on this line is just constant, I mean in x, but is function of time, then and phi is solution of the Laplace equation, then we can subtract this constant because it's additive constant. Okay, the far field condition are not satisfied, but yes, we are not concerned about it. Yes? And then it's this constant just appear over here and nowhere else, and we return to the original problem. So the idea was to idea is to use the simplified model as much as possible. If we correct it, it's better if we correct results, but not the procedure, to avoid complications with computations. And yeah, the pressures is fine. Okay, not fine, but better. The our results in red, in black, but that is the force. So that is the effect of gravity, right? And this is what I consider to be a result. If we now the effects which are responsible, right? Okay, we can make always long list of the effects. Everything is important, right? But if we now just two of these 100 effects, this is the result. And the, some people say, okay, it could be joke, but I believe it's right that usually any effect is governed by two forces, balance of two forces. It's sometimes, it's very special situation where the forces are three of them. It's very special. So if it's two, we always can find that model. Could be not for all condition over there. So we can make kind of the combination models and the links of these models. So the we can make, it's called theory. Right? So it's kind of that puzzles. So the model one over there, one over there, but all together they make a picture. And the picture, you can speak about that. You can explain what that. All right. And so there is more complicated, but the same story, the same we can do for the exit. For exit is more complicated because the in this case the boundary condition on the wall they are quite complicated, and we cannot satisfy them exactly. So we simplify this condition as well. But the result is I skip details because they are heavy, and I skip the details. But the result is over here. So the C of D is red line, and a generalized Wagner model is that line. And this is large displacement. It's almost everything there. It's almost everything there. And it's hard to say that we did new model. No, we use the same model, but we treated the results differently. That is the only what we did. And there is another model, so-called that modified Wagner, modified Logvinovich model, but it's not shown. It's even simpler. It's even simpler than that, and the result, unfortunately, it's even better than the that result. Yeah. So simpler model doesn't mean bad model at all. It can be much better than any, or not some complicated model. Yeah, that is the summary, and what I say, what I told you about the MLM. That is the even simpler model. So this is just a Wagner model with a nonlinear Bernoulli equation. So the linear in terms of kinematics and nonlinear in terms of dynamics. And the result is that one. So I said better because during the impact stage, it just gives the same result as CFD. Just the same. So, but it costs nothing. It's actually it's formula, but the result is amazing. Not in all condition. In some cases, for some motion, it's complicated. Yeah, and then we go to. No, we're not going there. Okay, I'll do like this. So that is that slide, and then. Just the same, so far I showed you two-dimensional problems. It's axisymmetric problem. The result is the same. The model is the same. The key formula is that one. It's the solution of mixed boundary value problem for the circular disk which moves up and down. Right? And the difference is just this 2 over pi. This 2 over pi makes difference between axisymmetric and two-dimensional problem. The rest is the same. Calculated differently because to calculate force we need to integrate over the two-dimensional not line, but yeah, the all other things they are the same. This means that we can validate this model not only by computation but also by experiments. But it was complicated, so it was not easy, but finally we succeeded thanks to Patricia and Habier from University of Madrid there. And what they did, okay, we discussed, and they did that catapult with the plate sitting on water surface, and that is the impact mechanism. So the weight drops down, impact this part, and the this level rotates and leaves the plate at high acceleration and with high force. So all dimensions are shown over here. So that is the acrylic plate with a radius 10 centimeter, thickness 1 centimeter. So the last time Patricia showed this result, she brought with her that disk to show you could touch it, right? And you see, that is of that size. I have no that disk with me. That is size, and the thickness is 1 centimeter, right? So you can bend it? No, you cannot bend it. It's rigid. That is the point. And this was our mistake, and thanks to Tatiana, we overcome that mistake. Because we still, you know, we still our experience and what we are doing based on our previous experience, and that is bad. Because we are not kind of open-minded and we are still limited in our thinking. And some people are less limited than others. So that is the experimental result, and that is the disk. And that disk, yeah, just a moment. Yeah, you see, it goes up, 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 and lifting water. And that is the disk. There is nothing about the shape. Because if there are no contact with liquid, disk just go up without upward without any bringing nothing to the liquid. Right? So the draft is zero. Draft is zero. Okay. And that is the view from above. The dashed line. So the experiments done by Patricia, the dashed line is for contact line, so how it's shrinking, right? So is it shrinking as we said, so the proportional to the velocity or not? And you can see, just a moment, so Yeah, so time goes, but it doesn't move. And then it starts to move, yeah? You see, that is interesting. So it's already something strange. So we leave the disk, but contact line doesn't move. Why? It should move. It should go instantly to zero, but it's not. Oh, sorry, it's the same, yeah. And that is the C of T. Now it's a radius of the contact area, and you can see up to about 5 microseconds, okay, microseconds, the contact line doesn't move. And after that, it moves about its constant speed. And that is the side view. So again, nothing happening. You see, nothing happening. Even disk is moving, actually. Yeah, and after about microseconds, it starts to move, and that is how it's moving. Yeah, again, it's not many things about the capillary forces or viscosity. So they are somewhere, but hidden, but we do not know yet about them. Yeah, and this is the displacement, but it's important, displacement of this point. Displacement, not the disk, but that point, right? Because we measured that point. And initially, you can see up to 4 microseconds. It should be just 4. Should be 4, because it's in microseconds. So it doesn't move. This point doesn't move. And after that, it's accelerated. So that is the, it's strange. So the theory is complicated, so you should do but on the other hand, once you understand the theory, you can explain it. The experiments, sometimes it's much more complicated to explain, right? Perform experiments is complicated, but understand it sometimes it's even more complicated. So that is the experimental result. We measured there was the accelerometer and load cell. So we measured force, external force, which leaves the plate, and we measured the acceleration at the center of the disk. And that is the force, and you can see it's monotonically increasing up to 6 microseconds, but the acceleration oscillates. So that is not clear why it's so, and the reason is, I mean, I'm explaining why it's not so, during the initial five microseconds, the contact point doesn't move. This means that we can use a model without motion of the contact line, which is much simpler. Much simpler. So that is the equation of the motion, mass of the disk, equipped disk with accelerometer on it and everything, multiplied by acceleration of the disk, that A is shown over here, is equal to external force, that one, we measure it, minus hydrodynamic force. And hydrodynamic force is equal to, as I said, the MA, which is added mass multiplied by acceleration. And this is the added mass for the circular disk. And then, if we combine all together, we can find that from that theory, from added mass theory, that the force should be proportional to acceleration. But it's not. It's not. So that is the force, that is the acceleration. So they are not proportional. Something wrong with the theory. Something wrong what I claim to you that it's very nice. No, it's not very nice. Yeah, not very nice. Yeah. And then in our theory also we can could calculate the size of the radius of the contact area, so we calculate it, and by using the acceleration, measured acceleration, and it's not very good as well. You see, that is the prediction, theoretical prediction, and that is the actual motion. It's not good as well. So in theory, because the acceleration is not zero initially, so the disk starts to move at the very beginning, but it doesn't move in experiments. Yeah, so not everything good in this life, yeah, unfortunately. Yeah, but that is for rigid plate. And so far we did for rigid plate. If it's not rigid, Okay, plate is aged. Yeah, but the meaning of aged is different. Right? And actually, in this case, it should be treated as elastic. And this, what's happening, that is the force applied, and we measure acceleration over here, and once we apply the force, this part goes upward, but that part goes down. So the edge of the disk exit water, enter water. The center of the disk exits the water, but edge of the disk enters the water. So that is explained, but that is sketch. So we need to calculate. So this is what we, okay, it's not what we're thinking. No, no, no. It's we thought that is just crazy people can think in that way because the disk is rigid, right? It should be rigid, right? But the once we did calculations, yeah, it's a result of calculation, but it's a sketch of the result of calculation. So we did the we calculated the velocity potential phi as a solution of that problem. It's not complicated, but now the acceleration of the disk is different at different point of the disk. It's not complicated because just this year in January we published paper in Journal of Fluid Mechanics about Doppler's impact on elastic plate, and some part of this analysis was done there. And you can think if we publish this January, so that is the results are from February. Yeah, it's about from February this year. Okay, less than 1 year old. And this is equation for free plate. Free plate means the edge of the plate are free of stresses and free of forces, shear forces. The plate dynamics it's governed by external force, external pressure caused by the force lifting the plate, and the hydrodynamic pressure, which comes from the solution of that problem. So that is the linearized hydrodynamic pressure. We consider only initial stage at which the contact point, because of that, a contact line doesn't move. So in this case, you see the R, which is initial radius of the disk. And we can solve this problem. Okay? So it's a coupled problem, because the motion depends on the potentially on the elastic deflection of the plate, and the elastic pressure depends on the elastic vibration of the plate. Yeah. So we use the normal mode method, and we did calculations, and in particular for dry plate, for the condition of experiments, we found the the lowest mode period is 1.6 milliseconds, and second mode 0.4. So that one is already of the same scale as the results of experiments. We measured everything from 0 to 6 microseconds. So in terms of the scales, time scales, that is period of the dry mode vibration, the scales are similar. Also, this is dry plate. For wetted plate in contact with water, the period is larger. So this is the reason why there is a coupling. And this is strong coupling. And actually, that is the elasticity which explains everything what we did. But okay, we did calculation. It's for many modes. You can see actually infinite. But finally, only one mode was included. Yes, and then we arrive at that not complicated two-dimensional second-order differential equation. And I should return back. Yeah, so that is the deflection of the plate. Deflection of the plate consists of two parts. One of them, aged motion of the plate, and that is the elastic modes of the plate. A, N are amplitudes of that mode, and W, N are the shape of that mode, which are solution of that problem, spectral problem. Right. So in one mode approximation, we got that one. So the blue line, or kind of shifted blue line, that one, dashed line, it's experimental, and a red line is theoretical. And this calculation, to do this calculation of the acceleration of the plate, we use the force measured in experiment. So for each run, we can calculate a solution of that second order differential equation, which is not very complicated, and make that pictures. And you can see over here what that acceleration made of. So that is the theoretical acceleration at the center of the plate. It's made of two parts, elastic and hydrodynamic. Hydrodynamic part is over here, that one. And this is the, so that one. Rigid part, yeah. Rigid part is that one. And this is the velocity, the force. Yeah, that is the force, applied force to the body. And you can see that the rigid part and velocity, acceleration of rigid motion, and rigid motion means acceleration of the center of mass, right? Without deflection. It's well correspond to the force. But what we measure, it's not rigid motion. We measure acceleration at one point. One point means we measure acceleration with a rigid plus elastic, and elastic acceleration is that one. So first the elastic mode is accelerated upward, but after that is decelerated significantly. So you start vibrating. Then there is an interesting line, that one. It's a red dashed line. It's acceleration of the edge. And you see, you can see that initially H goes down. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Then to explain this, you can see that this is equation for rigid motion. This is that one and this one. They are these two lines, blue, dark blue, and dark lines. So that is the force with account for rigid mass, and that is the acceleration, rigid acceleration. And that part correction is from elasticity, and that correction is comes with that coefficient, which depends on the mass of everything. And that coefficient, because these two lines, they are close to each other, so we can expect that this coefficient is small, and indeed it's small. It's 1/5. Indeed it's small. Yeah. And that is about the acceleration of the edge. So we did several other cases, because the each run gives the its own force and its own acceleration, and all of them are well. I cannot say that the theoretical results well. I mean, one-to-one predict the experimental results, but please remember that our model is our calculations are axisymmetrical, and the experiments are not axisymmetrical. The plate is circular, but the arrangement of everything, all the contacts are rectangular. And that the once we place the accelerometer, it has a weight and it has a size, and we glue it, right? And also the support mechanism is not taken into account. And this is the reason why we didn't go beyond the first mode. Because, we can do calculation with 2, 3, 10, 20, 100 axisymmetric mode, but it doesn't approach, we couldn't expect that we approach the solution, because physics is not axisymmetric. So this is why we account only for the leading order results. And thank you for your listening. That is, by the way, again about the lapping and exit. So the cut laps, it's difficult to you cannot see it, because it's happening very quickly. It's cuts take it tongue and doing like that, the suck it. So. Others, dogs doing about the same, but in particular, dogs are not so careful as cats, so they consider us as bad drinkers. In terms of the, they making, mess around. Thank you for your attention. Thank you. Yeah, it's almost time.
Thank you. I think we all saw the beauty of these equations, and if we didn't understand all of them immediately, how beautiful our hearing could do about this phenomenon. Who has some questions?
Yeah. We continue to work on it, but the recently, actually this month, Alan Tassan from Brest, he presented in the Journal Hydrodynamic, there is the conference in France. He presented, he sent us the paper. He studied the what's about that gamma happening for different shape. He did experiments with the circular disk, with the quadratic, with the elliptic disk, and but he didn't change the surfaces or quality of surfaces. That's the still nobody did it. And he found that in this simulation, that gamma is equal to 2. So motion of the contact line is twice of the velocity of the velocity of the fluid at that point. I don't know why. So that is that value was taken from comparison with the CFD result. In time, just constant. Yeah, and it's either 1 or 2. It's in this calculation, it's 2. Yeah, in that our simulation. In simulation there are no that constant. In theory only. Yeah. But it's not certain. It's not certain what that, but in a simulation we use 2. Yeah. As to Alan, he compared motion of the contact line, computed and measured. He did this is on his own, so the I cannot show his results. So he compared the contact line motion, I mean in axisymmetric case, and he concluded that that coefficient is 1. But then he computed the force by Abacus, and he computed the force by our formula, added mass multiplied by acceleration, and he concluded that it's 2. So dynamics and kinematics, still problem. So the for something it's like that, no certain answer. Yeah, it's done. Yeah, it's after that it was discovered that it's elastic. So the experiments were done with 5 millimeters and 2 centimeters plate, and it's well confirmed that, done. Yeah. And we submitted paper, GFM, just a few weeks ago on that. So it's everything quite fresh.
There's no recording anymore.
Okay. So you can ask any questions. Even say so. Yeah.
Other questions from the room? The Maurice?
What about trapped air?
There are no trapped air. I mean in exit. In? Over here there were no air. And also the in computation, like CFD computations, with exit. With entry. Wedge entry in water. There were also no air interrupt. So to be for air to be interrupt, the body should be kind of flat, more or less flat. Right? Interestingly, that I didn't believe it, but the it's happening that the air cushion is stable effect. So it's trapped. I remember in one paper making a review of the models and making that small paragraph about the air cushion. I wrote, it's unstable because if your body is inclined a little bit or something happening, then the air just escape and there are no air cushion. It's still there. I don't know why. It's very, very stable. But I believe if we can if we calculate the forces, the air cushion could give little effect. So it's more give effect in terms of the pressure distribution and the flows and difficulties. This analysis. But I believe if we solve the problem with air, and in particular the all that open form simulations, they were they done with air. But the if we exclude the air, but it's difficult to exclude from open form, as I understand. If with air or without air, the result is essentially the same. Yeah, but it could be difficult. Could be different if we consider, for example, the box with flat bottom impacting water. Yeah, but in exit there are no air, because it's not like there is also interesting problem if we leave the body from bubbly liquid, or bubbles. So that even contact line is made of bubbles, or some bubbles are there. I mean, if the bubbles in the fluid, right, and you place a body on the surface of the fluid, you lift it, but because the suction for loads are negative, so that bubbles near the contact, they start to grow, and it could be cavitation. It depends. It could be like because the cavitation also different. There is a interface cavitation and cavitation inside the fluid, right? That is kind of the interface cavitation. It's very likely to happen. Not the vapor pressure. No. Even for very large acceleration, like in this experiment, up to 200 meter per second squared, it's not enough for cavitation. It's not enough. So the for acceleration should be I don't remember several times higher than that to make. So that is interesting. Yeah. Interesting. So, in some sense, it's interesting to think that we discussed yesterday somebody that if you take a pipe, right, put it into the water, vertical pipe with piston inside, right, and move the piston, water will follow the piston, right, and so we can leave the water, right. But the same can be done without pipe. If there are no pipe, just piston, we also can leave the water. But the effect is different because with pipe it's hydrostatic, right? Hydrostatic, so we can keep the water at any level. We cannot do this. That is dynamic. Everything about dynamics, inertia. Everything about inertia. Yeah.